I wanted to make car TV shows. I started off in radio, local radio as a presenter. I was starving to death.
What first sparked your interest in cars and motorbikes and drew you to speaking about them in a public sphere?
Cars were always an obsession. I'm not particularly unusual like that. As a kid growing up in Birmingham, immediately. I mean, to be fair, my grandfather worked in the car industry. He built cars. He was a coach builder at Mulliners in Birmingham and at Jensen later than that. So it was always in my blood. Always loved cars. When I was about five, sitting next to my dad's armchair, I remember we were working out how many days until I could learn to drive a car. And then we worked out it was 365 fewer days until I could ride a motorcycle. So although nobody in my family rode a motorcycle, I became obsessed with motorbikes. By the time I was 16, I'd said it so much that my parents couldn't turn around and say, no, you can't have one. So I'd got a job by then, my part-time job, I was at school, was a chicken farm. And I'd saved up enough to buy a little secondhand 50cc bike, which was in the yard outside my house. By then we were living in North Yorkshire. I'd had to go to the library to get a book to learn how to ride a motorbike because there was no internet then and nobody in my family could ride a motorbike. So I learned from a book and on my 16th birthday, started practicing and took myself out on a little motorbike. So it's always been there. And I think it stayed with me because, you know, I'm interested in human beings. I am one. And I think as a machine, it moves us physically. Thereby, it's inevitable that it moves us emotionally. We built it to enable us to do everything beyond gain shelter from our houses, our caves. Everything else that is required in our lives demands we go out and get it. So we built the car, the motorcycle, as a machine to go and get food, friendship, a mate, resources, water, whatever. So it's incredibly important to us. And then journalism was my natural calling as a career, I suppose. That makes it sound more exciting, pompous than it really is, but it's what I fell into. And so combining it with a love of cars and motorbikes was kind of inevitable.
Obviously, you and Jeremy Clarkson and James May have become like an iconic trio over the years, of course, but I wonder how, when you look back, how would you describe your experience working together?
It's been incredible. It is an amazing thing to get to do. I wanted to make car TV shows. I started off in radio, local radio as a presenter. I was starving to death and realized I just couldn't earn a living. So, but I wanted to get to do car shows. I wanted to do talking, really. So I got a job. I was very lucky. I landed a job in PR at Renault UK, thanks to a guy called Tim Jackson who gave me the job, with a view to getting to know the editors of the car shows. I did. I got to know a guy called Pete Baker, who ran all the car programming on Granada Men and Motors. He gave me a bit of work, so I did that for 8, 9 years. And then I auditioned for and got the job on Top Gear. But none of us had any idea it became what it became. We were all experienced car journalists on screen and in print. And that's what we set out to do. And we set out never with any grander aim than making the best car show we can. That's all we've ever done.
What do you feel like you've learned from each other during your time presenting together?
good and bad. I suppose we will have learned a lot from each other. We've had an influence on each other because, you know, we spend an immense amount of time together when we're traveling, when we're filming. People often ask, oh, do you hang out a lot outside of work? Well, back in the day when we were making, 14 shows a year, sometimes more on Top Gear, we never were apart. So, yeah, we'll have learned from each other.
And obviously, you talk about the recent special of the Grand Tour, which I thought was very fun. But obviously, for you, it's still you have a lot more problems than the other two with your Aston Martin. So I wonder, how did you find driving through Mauritania and that experience?
I was really excited. Well, we were all excited to get there because of the associations with the Paris-Dakar, the Dakar race, which is like the Baja in the States. It's rally raid, so it's about powerful, fast cars going really fast off-road. So we were looking forward to that. And it was an incredible place to visit, big and almost empty. And we're always at our best when we sort of cast adrift somewhere remote, slightly hostile climate and terrain. So it was an absolute joy to make. It's an incredible place to go. And it's wonderful to visit these places, taking with us a crew that we know are so good at capturing it and delivering it to your sitting room via your television, which sounds old fashioned, I suppose it is, but they are incredibly good at it. So it's a real joy to be back making those films.
Was there anything that you felt was different or made Mauritania distinctly, you know, interesting experience for you?
About the country, one, that this is a simple fact, the heat, my God, it's hot, it's a very dry heat, and we're experienced travellers, but trying to stay hydrated and still functioning was hard, and it punished the cars beyond belief. I think a real joy for us was because it had been a while since we'd really been able to get out somewhere remote, been with COVID and lockdowns and all the rest of it. So to be able to take our familiar, talented crew out somewhere and unleash them on somewhere that people won't have seen and won't have been was a real pleasure. And you kind of know, and it's a real satisfaction, even when you're exhausted and hot and dehydrated, frustrated with your car because it's not working, and you know you've got hours of driving ahead and it's punishing. But you know, just looking at the side and think, that looks incredible. And I know there's a crew over there who's going to be capturing that, and it's going to look amazing. And that'll translate through the television. Then it keeps you going.
Yeah, especially when your car is turning against you. Like,
especially when, if like me, you've chosen the wrong car to do it in, which I undoubtedly did.
Yeah, obviously it was a challenging experience for you, but I wonder what was kind of the favourite moment of being there and doing that show?
My favourite moment was probably the first one, because it always is for me. It's after all the planning and the preparation and getting everybody there. I mean, just if you imagine just getting our film kit into a country, all of that, it's a huge mission. But everybody's finally there and finally set, and this is the start moment. This is the moment. And when the director, usually Phil Churchwood, in fact it always is, calls action, and we look up and there's a familiar sea of faces holding cameras, and I look across and there's the other two idiots. And it is like we've stepped into a version of ourselves that's always out there somewhere wild doing what we do. And we inhabit that version of ourselves. And it's wonderful. I love that stepping off moment when you just think, here we go, back into our world.
You know, there's only one more special left. So I wonder what's kind of next for Clarkson, Hammond and May. And did you feel like it was the right time to say goodbye to the Grand Tour?
We've worked together a very long time and been lucky to share some just simply incredible experiences that no one of us ever thought would come our way. And not just share them with our mates, but share them with a global audience, which again, we never thought we'd have the opportunity to do. And we're still right now in the process of doing that. These films are enormous, and they are films really. So we're an enormous crew. It's a huge combined effort to make them. And when we bring back the thousands of hours of footage, thousands of hours, when we call wrap at the end of the shoot, that isn't the end of the job. It's still a huge process to get it assembled and made and the full service done. So we're still in that process. We're delivering this one now when it's all come together and finally the voiceover's done and the picture is graded and locked and delivered. Then for a while now, we're going to be sitting back desperate to see what do people think. Did it work? Did we capture the spirit of where we went? So that'll occupy us for a while yet. We're still in the process of making the next one. Shot it, but we're going to make it. So that will occupy us. So really our attention hasn't turned up to anything that follows until we get there. The key thing on that whole issue, we had decided years ago that we wanted to be in control, having set off on this incredible adventure that none of us thought would ever come our way. We worked hard and we worked for decades. We never thought it would come our way. Having set off on it, we all wanted to be the ones, and I don't just mean us three, all of us, to decide when and where and how we landed it. And we have done, but that isn't uppermost in our minds yet because we haven't finished.
What were the movies that you loved growing up, and do you remember your first cinema trip?
I loved Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid and anything with cars in it, literally anything with cars in it. The first time I went to the cinema as a kid was to see Star Wars. I didn't understand a damn thing about it, but I liked it because the spaceships were a bit like cars, so I was happy.
I love that. What was the first film to make you cry, if any?
I watched... There's a black and white version, isn't there, of Notre Dame? With the Hunchback of Notre Dame. Yeah, I cried at that as a kid.
And what TV shows were you obsessed with growing up?
You won't be surprised. The Dukes of Hazzard, The A-Team, Top Gear. Daktari, when I was very young. Yeah, basically my life.
What was the first single or album that you bought?
The first single was Adam and the Ants, Kings of the World Frontier.
And if you could choose one song to define your life, what would it be and why?
Oh, good Lord. Can I choose two? Because they're so different. It would be, on the one hand, Iggy Pop, Lust for Life. Because I love it. It's still... I love the sentiment of it. And it's summed up in the title. You know, well, there aren't many more lyrics than that anyway. I simply love it. But also, I am by nature quite a light touch person. I don't really want to be... I don't want to make a big impact. A song by JJ Cale called Call Me the Breeze. And I love the idea of being just that, just a brief coalescence of atoms giving rise to a consciousness that drifts across the planet, interacts gently, and then drifts away again. So they're two very contrasting songs. So if you maybe mash those up and come out with some hideous mix, which would be impossible, it would be that.
Were there any mentors in your life or your career that had, or who had a defining influence on you?
Oh yeah, loads. Guy called Alan Greaveson, who took me under his wing when I started in radio in 1988, and taught me the basics of radio broadcasting. You never refer to your audience in the plural. Lots of important things I learned from him. A guy called Tim Jackson, who gave me my job at Renner UK when I left radio and I got into the car industry briefly to try and get to know the editors of the car shows. Tim gave me the job as the press officer because I had shoes with laces and buckles on them. They were fascinating. He was a gentleman to the core, and I loved him. And we lost him a few years ago, sadly. A guy called Pete Baker, who gave me my break in Granada Men and Motors. Obviously, also, I have to say, it makes me feel a bit sick to do it, but Andy Wilman and Jeremy. But, you know, I auditioned for the job on Top Gear and they gave me the job, so thank God. I'll be forever grateful to them. Lots of people.
If you could go back in time and give young Richard any advice on how to change his origin story, what would it be and why?
I wouldn't go so far as to say, don't worry, it'll all be all right, because then I wouldn't try. And I had to try, we all do. But I would say, keep trying, and it will work out, but keep trying.